A very good evening to everyone, all the participants. I hope I'm audible. With the background which Adelina has set, we are going to discuss today about the very important recent amendments that were introduced in the income tax laws pertaining to NGOs. The context here for today's session is basically knowledge sharing, firstly. Just a short disclaimer here that the views that would be expressed here are all my personal views, and it is always advisable to take professional assistance when any NGO is going ahead for filing their renewals. So with that, let us begin with today's session, as most of the participants I understand are from NGO background. I will keep the subject very, very simple. I would not want to complicate it unnecessarily with sections and, you know, the law, etc. I'll try to decode it and simplify this concept, because you know, the generic view in the industry outside now, especially the NGO ecosystem, is this is a very complicated thing. So undoubtedly it is complicated, but let us try to break it down. Let us try to make some sense out of this newly introduced law. So just let me know if I'm audible. In case if not, please feel free to put a message in the chat box, and I've shared my screen as well. So we are going to cover certain aspects today, and I have listed down here. Adelina, I can see some red lines on my screen. I don't know.
Yes, you can disable the annotation from your end for the participants. At the top, we have the Zoom bar, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So at the extreme right corner, there should be a button that says more options.
Okay.
Which gives you the option of disabling annotation for others.
But I'm not sure.
So there should be a black-gray bar of Zoom.
Yeah, yeah.
Extreme right corner of that bar.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay.
Yes.
So I think I've done it. Okay.
And now you can clear the annotation by clicking on the annotation button on the Zoom bar, and then can click on the trash box button, right? Erasing everyone's annotation, basically.
Okay, done.
Thank you.
Great, thanks. So we're going to firstly discuss what is the rationale of this amendment which was introduced, and what is this amendment all about? Now, firstly, please try to understand, income tax law contains certain provisions for charitable organizations and for certain institutions which are doing charitable activities or religious activities for that matter. So considering that there were trusts which were very, very age old, that, you know, 40, 50 years they have been into existence, and there was no digitalization back then. Now we are seeing a lot of developments in the sense the income tax portal has been revamped, as you all may be aware, recently. So there is a lot of digital thing happening even at the tax department level, with a view to have all, like a repository of NGOs and maintaining a central record of which NGO is operating in India. The plan was made to introduce this particular amendment, wherein they would ask for a renewal of their registrations. So today we are going to use certain terms such as renewal, reapproval, re-registration. See, ultimately everything is the same, but yes, there is a context to it, that why such terms are being utilized. Now, so as I mentioned, the plan of the department is to have a central repository so that they come to know what sort of impact is happening when it comes to the NGO's ecosystem. So there is a lot of sustainability, nowadays we hear a lot about sustainable development, what sort of impact are NGOs making when it comes to, you know, sustainability. So to understand to assess what sort of impact it has been making, this idea of, you know, amending the income tax, because all sorts of NGOs usually prefer to take an income tax exemption, and that's where they decided, let us try to bring in this renewal concept or re-registration. Now, when is it that this particular new law starts, or what is the applicability, is what we are going to discuss. The applicability of this particular law actually was in the previous year, but due to the pandemic, they extended the due date, but it was finally brought into effect with effect from 1st of April 2021. So, इसका मतलब ये है कि 1st April 2021 को ये नया कानून लागू हो जाता है and trusts are required to re-register themselves with the income tax authorities. They have given certain timelines which I will talk about and how that procedure has to be followed. That also I will discuss today. That is the third point, that is the procedure and timeline. Apart from that, there were a lot of points which were never there in the, those were never required by the trust to be done. So the department introduced certain additional compliances now, which are in the form of, statement of donations or certificates of donations. So earlier, as majority of the participants are coming from NGO ecosystem, they would be aware, aisa kuch kanun tha nahi. It was not there. So now if it has been introduced, it is very, very important to understand what sort of, requirement our NGO is going to have. So that is one of the points that we'll be talking about. And some of the peculiar issues, as far as these procedures are concerned, we are going to discuss. So I can see a hand raised here. Maybe I'll take the, all the questions, everything towards the end of the session. Moving forward. Now I have tried to, give a brief synopsis of this amendment. So firstly, which trusts or NGOs are required to get the renewal done or the re-registration done? So as you all may be aware that in income tax, exemptions are provided under Section 12A, 12AA, and Section 80G for the donations. Also, there is one approval mechanism that is in the form of Section 1023C for hospitals, medical institutions, educational institutions. So that is the section which governs, and there are certain peculiar conditions which are prescribed in the Income Tax Act. And also certain approvals are given for scientific research organizations in Section 35. So this particular renewal is firstly getting applicable on these sections under which trusts used to take registration in the erstwhile law. One of the very important thing now to be noted is there is going to be an alphanumeric, code or a unique registration number, which is going to get allocated to every trust on and from 1st of April 2021. This unique registration number is basically, this was never there, as I said, in the erstwhile requirements or anywhere in the law. Now, the purpose of having a URN is to sort of, as I said, to maintain that repository and to understand what sort of work an NGO is being doing. So it basically acts like a vigilance on the NGO ecosystem as well. So the URN is more like a unique number which has to be now obtained for doing any sort of charitable or religious activities. Now, this is one very important thing. We're going to discuss about that as well. Very importantly, the third point, that is this renewal and final registrations now will have a validity attached to it. That means it is going to be valid for 5 years only. So that means every 5 years, the trusts are required to re-register themselves. This used to be perpetual, as you all may be aware, in the erstwhile law. But now they have done away with that perpetual, registrations. Every 5 years, this renewal has to be done. There are certain timelines associated which needs to be taken care of by trust. But this is a very, very important amendment of 5 years, renewals to be done every 5 years. There is another concept of provisional registration that has been introduced, which is being granted for 3 years. We'll talk about this thing. Also, as I mentioned, there was Section 12AA and Section 1023C in the erstwhile law. Registrations and approvals were granted for both of those sections, but now they have tried to curb that practice. They're saying you select one of them. That was the fifth point. And the last one is statement of donations, which is an additional compliance, if I were to put it, for the NGOs, and certificate of donations. So certificate of donations is something which, as a, you know, in the erstwhile law, that was not a requirement. Now that's an official document that has to be given to the donor. And the donor would then, on the basis of that certificate, be able to file his income tax return and claim ATG deduction. Moving on to the next page. Now, we have already talked about the applicability, so I'm skipping this particular page. Now, the renewal procedures for existing registrations. Now, let me break this down. I will first talk about in this slide for the existing trust. When I say existing, they were already in existence and in operations as on 1st of April 2021. And they had taken either Section 12AA, Section 12A, ATG, or 1023C in the previous law. So the renewal procedure is applicable for such existing registered trusts as on 1st of April. So by this, they are now required to upload Form 10A. The due date that has been prescribed is 30th of June 2021. Unless it is further extended by the Income Tax Department. What the Income Tax Department has mentioned is, it's simply this Form 10A you file. We would not ask you anything. You comply to the rules that are prescribed, submit the attachments, submit the documents which has been asked, and we will give you the renewal. There is a timeline of 5 years for this renewal. Now, this is the first time, this is for the existing trusts only. I am going to come on new trusts or the trusts which were in existence but not having 12A. I will also discuss about that point. But please try and understand here what we are discussing in this particular slide is the timeline and also some bit of the procedure of how this particular renewal would be granted. So, very, very important point is that there is not going to be any sort of inquiry. Department aapse kuch nahi puchega isme. Aap form sahi tarike se upload kar dijiye. Department is not going to ask you. It will give you a renewal. But there is one small point which you should factor in is that if later it is found out that some of the documents are not appropriately attached or they are missing or as prescribed by the rules, but you have not filed or submitted to the department along with Form 10A, then the department has the right. Please note this point. This is very important. Then the department has the rights and power to cancel this particular renewal. Now, this is a little tricky condition. So it becomes very, very apparently clear that the department is not wanting you to submit incorrect information. You need to please note this point that whatever you file with Form 10A has to be in line and in accordance with the rules that has been prescribed. Moving on to the next slide. I see some question. I'll take as in when I feel in the chat box, when will the new IT portal be ready? Sir, yeah, I understand there is a Mr. Siva. I think this is one of the points which is troubling everyone. The IT portal is not yet ready, and at times the even if you are able to successfully log in, but the form doesn't appear over there. So in some of the cases we saw that Form 10A is not there. In fact, Form 10, which was there in the previous law, that's visible. So all we can say is that we will have to wait until and unless all these technicalities are resolved. Will they extend the date? Well, to my mind, today is 19th. Nothing has officially been announced, but then probably this date should be, in my view, extended. How can the department give 30th as a deadline? So here the deadline, see, this deadline was 30th of June. That was, we all were aware that was the deadline as on 1st of April as well. But then the revamping of this portal was not something which was out, that they are going to do this revamping of the entire portal, and that too it will be taking so many days. So I think initially when they announced, they mentioned that for the first week of June, that is from 1st of June to 7th of June, the portal may not be available. But then we've been seeing that there are a lot of technical issues which people are facing. They are unable to register their DSCs. Some of them are not even able to register. Forget about registering DSC. They're not able to log in. So here there is a gap, and we are expecting the department to come out with certain relief. Only time will tell what they announce. Moving on, I'll take the questions later on. Moving on to the next slide. Now here, what I have put down is a summary of the timelines, and this is very, very critical for the participants to understand. Now, in the previous slide, we talked about a trust who is existing, doing business, having operations, registered under 12A and the erstwhile law, also having ATG, and applying for renewal re-registration. That's getting covered under point number one here, that you are already registered, approved, file 10A, apply until 30th of June unless extended, and you will be granted registration, that is the final registration, within 3 months from the end of the month in which the application is filed, and this will be valid for a period of 5 years. So assumingly, if you filed your form, say, by 30th of June, within 3 months from the end of the month in which this application was filed, the department will give you the renewal certificate, which is going to have a validity of 5 years. So this is very, very clear. Majority of the cases would be falling under the first category. Now, let me go to point number six here. Because right now, please note that the form that has been introduced is only form 10A. What you will be able to see on the portal is only form 10A. There is no form 10AB, while the law says that there is also another form 10AB. And I will just discuss by the means of this particular slide, what is form 10AB. The residual category is the category number six, which is here. Again, you can see on the slide that there is form 10A. So what this residual category means altogether? It means that, for instance, I am a Section 8 company, which is, say, incorporated on 15th of April, 2021. I can be incorporated on 15th of April. I got my certificate of incorporation. I was never into existence as on 1st of April, 2021. But now I have got a fresh incorporation done, and I will be doing my charitable activities. So in that very case, the concept of provisional registration shall come into picture. For every new trust on or after 1st of April 2021, aap residual category mein aake form 10A upload karoge. Form same hai. It's the same form. Form ka naam bhi same hai, form 10A hai. Lekin aapki category badal gayi hai. When I say category, there are certain codes which are given in the form. I will take you through the forms right now. I have included in the presentation so that you will understand how critical is the selection in the form. Form 10A aap bharoge, aapko provisional registration de diya jayega jo 3 saal ke liye valid hoga. Now this will be given from within 1 month from the end of the month in which the application is filed. Now this is just a provisional registration. Yahan tak clear hai that there are two categories where 10A has to be filed. One is already having registration. Majority of the cases and the concern area should be for these cases, I would say, that jinke paas mein purana 12A tha, unko to 30th June ke pehle hi apply karna hai and take your registrations for 5 years. The residual category will be getting a provisional registration, and the provisional registration is also saying one very important facet, is that provisional registration is only going to be valid for a period of 3 years. Now, please try and understand, provisional registration is a registration which is being granted to new trust. Ye concept purane law mein nahi tha. Provisional registration ke baad mein, aapko ek final registration bhi leni padegi. If you are granted a provisional registration, it means you need to, within certain timelines, also apply for the final registration. Now, that is where clause number 6 will come into picture. Ye jo baaki ke clause hai, point number 2 se leke point number 5. Now, this is something where it can be situational. So, as I said, this validity is given for 5 years under Section 12AB. So that means category 2 here, if you can see, it is covering the particular trust which are given this registration, the fresh registration. 5 saal ke baad mein jab aapko wapas renewal karwana hai, you will be falling under this category and then you have to upload form 10AB. The provisional registrations which was granted under category 6, for them, you need to also apply now for final registration. And the timeline associated is 6 months prior to the expiry of your 3 years, the 3 years which I talked about here, either 6 months before the expiry, aap apply kar do final ke liye, or 6 months within 6 months of starting of your activities or operations. There is a, whichever is earlier concept, which is given for provisional registration. So in my example, I said that Section 8 company was registered, incorporated 15th of April, applied for Form 10A, got the provisional registration in Form 10A. Fine, that is valid for 3 years. But the moment they commence their activity, they need to, within 6 months, file for final registration. This is very, very important. You have to ensure that you are getting a final registration which is for 5 years. Provisional registration, to aapko ek tarah se, it is basically expediting you to start your activities. But that doesn't mean that you don't have to apply for a final registration. This is a very important area for the trusts which are now going to get incorporated, I would say, newly. Also, for your information, Form 10AB is not visible. It was not visible when the portal was working online. I'm not sure whether in the new IT portal, whether this Form 10AB is going to come out or not. But as of now, it's not visible. There is one section they have introduced, that is Section 11.7. What this 11.7 says, that if your particular registration was inoperative due to some reason, then you have to also apply for final registration within 6 months prior to the start of the assessment year. This section is also, for the time being, you can keep aside, because inoperative hua nahi hai. Abhi to sabko inoperative kar diya hai first se. So ye jo relevant section 4 hai, ye abhi tak apply nahi hoga as of now. The last point is modification of objectives. A lot many times, NGOs decide to change their objectives. They feel that, okay, we missed out on something. We need to cover this for the betterment of the society. At that point in time, whenever you are modifying your particular objectives, you have to ensure that within 30 days, you are filing for form for final registration in Form 10AB. Now, I understand this timelines. You know, when you look at it, it looks a little complicated. But if you break it down and if you try to categorize yourself, where do you fall? You will try to understand that in a nutshell, what is applicable now is only Form 10A. 10AB would not get applied as of now. Aap Form 10A proper tarike se bhariye, with the correct selection of the codes, you will get your final registration, or if you are in the residual category, you will get your provisional registration. Moving on to the next slide. Now, this is, one second, let me just see if I can share the forms with you. Just let me know if you are able to see my screen, Adelina. I have opened up the form 10A. Is my screen visible?
As of now, we can see the slide that says, let's understand the form.
Okay, one second. I'll just reshare my screen so that people are able to see. Now, is it visible?
Yes, we can see the form. Okay. Maybe you could zoom in.
Yeah, sure. So this is the Form 10A. Please note that there are six sections like this. And for the trust which are going to be already applying for a renewal, that is, they are existing as on 1st of April, most of the part will be pre-filled, like, you know, your PAN number, your registration date, etc. And if you have filed your returns on time in the previous years, certain parts will be freezed in this form. You won't have to submit the details such as, you know, all these things. In case if you have filed your return of income for the previous financial year. So what I'm trying to say here, my point is, we would not be able to cover up all the points in this, you know, in this 1 hour session today. But there are certain very critical aspects of this form which has to be taken care of. For example, if you see, they are asking for something called as Darpan ID or FCRA if you are having a registration. Now, all this was never asked earlier, but now they want you to submit this information on at the time of filing this particular application. Registration number, date of registration. Now, usually for a trust, for example, if it is registered by the registrar of the trust, it will be given a unique number. So that's the same number that you need to put here. And you need to put the date of registration, which authority granted you this particular registration, etc. From when was it applicable and all those things. As far as details of authors, founders, settlers, there is a drop-down option that has been provided. And you need to select the proper designation also. You need to then particularly put the unique identification number, which is nothing but the PAN card number of that particular person. The rest details will be pre-filled the moment you put the PAN card. You have to just ensure that those details are correct. Post that, as I mentioned, if you are a compliant trust, point number 10 would probably not be applicable to you, because any which ways you have filed your return in the past. Most of the points for a regular compliant trust would not be applicable in this particular thing, in this particular form. Moving back to my presentation, Adelina, is it visible? Just let me know, please.
Yes, we can see your presentation.
Is it on the full screen?
Yes.
So here I've tried to, you know, conceptualize the key aspects of that form 10A. Firstly, it's a common form. So when I say it's a common form, what I mean is this. Let me just show you. So here, there is a code which you need to select. Now, if you go to the instruction manual of this particular form, you will realize that there are many codes. There are, I think, around 11, 12 codes from which you need to select where do you categorically fall. Now, here comes the critical part. My suggestion to trust is, please be very sure what you're filling in this section code. And in case if there is a confusion, please take professional advice while filling, because the moment you fill up something wrong, it can have repercussion. So this section code is something which you need to select. This is where you took the registration earlier. What sort of activities you were doing? Were you a religious trust? Were you a charitable, etc.? If you, in case you are a religious, then in that very case, you won't be able to apply 80G, because 80G is not available to religious trust. For a charitable trust, yes, definitely, it has to be Form 10A. It is Form 10A for both the sections, that is 12A and 80G. There is no such thing that there is only one form. There is a lot of confusion that is it only one form that we have to file for both the sections? That's not the case. You need to file two different forms. The form name is the Form 10A only, but it has to be filed twice. Section code, as I said, other registration details I have covered, like, you know, the Darpan ID, etc. Darpan ID is basically for receiving grants. As I said, certain form, the components of this form would be pre-filled at times. The details of authorized person we have discussed. Now coming to the attachment segment of it. Now there is a attachment tab which will get open up when you preview and file this particular form. There are six attachments which they have asked, which you need to attach. And it is important now to ensure that those documents are properly signed, legible, and attached. There is a size limit of 50 MB and PDF that has been prescribed. Also, the application has to be signed by the person who is authorized to upload the tax returns of the particular trust or the NGO. That is very, very important. And of course, the new ID portal is demanding everyone. We all would have got emails from the tax authorities department to register your DAC. So that's one point which I have covered here. Now, what are the documents which one has to attach with this Form 10A? So if, for example, I'm a trust which is registered under the Trust Act, and there is a trust deed, so I have to attach that as the first attachment. The second attachment would not be valid because I have an instrument in place. The second is basically a document evidencing the creation. In case if you are, so at times in the earlier, you know, periods, I'm talking about the age-old trust, which was just formed. There was no instrument. There was no formal instrument. It was just like on a simple, you know, understanding. They formed a trust. So that document has to be now attached. Now here, it is a very big issue for the age-old trust who are not able to trace their original documents. Now, what is to be done in such a case? We'll try to cover it in the issues areas. The FCRA registration has to be attached. The original 12A, 12AA, as the case may be. So, in certain cases, we found that, you know, the original 12A, 12AA, they are not available, they are lost, misplaced. What to do? In such situations, it is always advisable to put a note that we are unable to find, but at least the registration number has to be correctly mentioned, because I'm sure you can lose out on a 12A, you know, original certificate, but not on your registration number. But yes, it is a requirement to now submit as an attachment. And the annual accounts of prior 3 years, if you're a compliant trust, this particular requirement would not be really, you know, relevant for you, because you have been submitting your returns on time. But still, it is advisable to, since they have asked as a separate point, please attach the annual account. There is no activity attachment that has been given, that, you know, you attach your activity report, etc. All those things are not required to be attached in Form 10. These are the 6 requirements. They have to be attached. So when you are applying for 12A renewal, this is the requirement. When you apply for 80G, the requirements are more or less the same. Documents have to be attached in both the cases, when you are filing for 12A and for 80G, because both the forms are separate, the name of the form is same. Which form has to be filed first? A question may come to your mind, whether we should file for 80G, 12A, your wish. You can do simultaneously, you know, back to back, you can file as the case may be. There's no such requirement to file 12A first and then 80G. Moving on. So that was the part about 10A. And the instruction manual, if you see here, the form gives you a very broad list of instruction manual, which I'm talking about. Now, honestly, if you try to, read this, it will be very, very difficult to understand. And that's where you should always try to take a professional advice, because if you are selecting the wrong code, it can have repercussions. And now I'm going to discuss what repercussion. So there is a requirement. This is a new requirement of submitting a statement of donation annually from financial year 21-22 onwards. This is applicable from 2021-22. The due date will be next year, 31st of May 2022. There is a Form 10B that you need to file, and that has to be done electronically. In case if there is a delay in filing this, then the trust and the NGOs would be subjected to some late fee, which has been prescribed to INR 200 per day. And also there can be a penalty from 10,000 to a lakh of rupee. Now, this is some additional compliance and additional, I would say, requirement. And trust have to be mindful that there is this new law now, which requires them to give the details of donation that they have received. So, for example, there is one important thing here. If you don't submit this information, then what is the effect on the person who has donated or given you the donation? Whether he'll be able to claim the deduction? Very, very contentious issue as of now. Only time will tell when we reach that stage next year. But to our mind, to my understanding, they are trying to auto-populate the details of the donation which a person is making, and the personal ITRs which will be filed for this particular financial year, that is 21-22, will be basis the statement the trust is uploading. So in case if you miss out on the bus, that particular person who has given you the donation may not be able to claim the donation, 80G deduction. So that is a very, very important repercussion, which trust has to be mindful and this has to be taken note. Some of the peculiar issues, some of them I already discussed, but considering that this is a new law altogether, as I said, it is a common form. Form 10A for 80G also, Form 10A for 12A also, and which has to be done simultaneously. You can upload one after the other, but you have to file it twice, and you will get separate registration certificates in 10AC from the department. So that is point number one, which is the confusion, that how this has to be uploaded. consequences of not filing the renewal forms within the prescribed time, that is, as of now, we consider it to be 30th June. What will happen if the trust do not renew, if the existing trust I'm talking about, if they do not renew their registration until the prescribed time, that is 30th of June, tab kya hoga, wo situation mein? इस सिचुएशन में ये होगा कि आपका जो एग्जेम्पशन का स्टेटस है वो लैप्स हो जाएगा, पहली बात तो. दूसरा, आपको जो डोनेशंस मिले हैं या आपकी जो इनकम हुई है वो मैक्सिमम मार्जिनल रेट 115 टीडी में टैक्सेबल हो जाएगी. तीसरा, वेरी इंपॉर्टेंटली, जो डोनर ने आपको डोनेशन दिया है वो एग्जेम्पशन नहीं ले पाएगा, उसको उसका बेनिफिट नहीं मिलेगा. These are the three peculiar conditions. Although there are certain views that, you know, you can take a condonation of delay, etc., etc. But keeping aside the condonation of delay, it is therefore very, very critical to ensure timely compliance of this particular, requirement of renewal, unless you wish to, you know, forego your particular exemption certificates or registrations. Now, we already covered the third question. Now, one important question which we often get is the genuineness of the activity. Ki yaar, genuineness kya kya cheez hai? Whether a trust will be required to prove their activities, prove their objectives to the department. Yes, it was a requirement earlier also, and it is a requirement today also. But when is this requirement going to come is a question. As I said, अगर आप ओरिजिनली 1 अप्रैल को रजिस्टर्ड थे, आप फाइल कर दीजिए, आपको अपना सर्टिफिकेट मिल जाएगा. कोई कुछ सवाल नहीं पूछा जाएगा आपसे. यू विल बी गिवन योर रजिस्ट्रेशन विद इन द प्रिस्क्राइब टाइम लिमिट. जेन्युइननेस कब प्रूव करनी पड़ेगी, या ऑब्जेक्ट्स को मुझे कब डिपार्टमेंट के पास में जाके समझाना पड़ेगा कि यार ये मैंने लिखा था और ये मैंने किया है. दिस विल हैव टू बी डन व्हेन पोस्ट 5 years यू आर गोइंग टू फाइल फॉर्म 10AB. नाउ एवरी 5 years when you go ahead for re-registration, that's when form 10AB is going to get filed and the genuineness will have to be proved. Also, one instance, if the department by themselves suo moto finds out that okay, you were not being able to probably do your activities the way you had given in your object clause, that's where they can give you an opportunity of being heard and ask you certain questions. But otherwise, genuineness is for the fresh cases, for the fresh registrations that you will do 5 years hence in by filing form 10AB, tab aapse bilkul pucha jayega ye cheez ki query, tab aayegi department ke side se. A lot many times they give a questionnaire, they ask you to reply to certain pointers, etc. One of the point which usually comes into question is the irrevocability clause, whether it is there in the trust deed or not. So ideally that irrevocability clause has to be mandatorily there. In case if not, then please try to put that in your trust deed through an amendment or something and submit that to the department that this irrevocability clause has been now included. The issue whether there is a government fees, of course, there is no government fees in making this renewal application. They are not asking for any fees. It may so happen that now department is moving to a faceless assessments, etc. That going forward, this entire regime of getting faceless exemption approvals will come into picture. I'm talking about something which may happen over a bit of time. There is one important condition when you fill the form, it comes up that attachment, in case if your original trust deed is in vernacular language, whether you have to submit a translated copy. Well, there is one point specifically that is coming in the form, and the generic view here is that it is not a mandatory requirement. In case if you have, then you attach. Else, you can just leave that point. Age-old trust, I've already covered that you're not able to trace your original income tax exemption certificate because that is a requirement in the form to be attached. Then what has to be done in such cases? You can probably give the registration number, and as I discussed that you can mention that we are unable to trace it. But your registration number should be absolutely correct, because on that registration number itself, you have been filing your returns since the past so many years, I would say. Now, some example, if I were to talk about, there is one very commonly asked question that what if I had filed the application in the erstwhile law on 1st of February 2021 and I was awaiting the approval. But the approval never came and this new law came into picture. So then you come under that transitionary, अपन ने जो timeline में देखा, 6 वाले में, आपको provisional registration दिया जाएगा. That is one of the question that is usually coming for the applications which were filed previously. उसको, they have bucketed into the new, regime of this new 12AB section. And very importantly, assuming that you filed on 1st of Feb 2021 and your approval was also given, let us consider on 31st of March. In such a situation, do you have to file? Yes, you will come under category 1 of the timeline. Because here, as I said, every trust which was registered as on 1st of April have to renew. So you can call it to be an additional compliance, but yes, that's the law. The last question which comes to us often is, it's a trust, and usually in the unorganized space I'm talking about, it's a trust. They were doing their business activity, generating income from property, getting donations, but never had taken 12AA or 80G ever in their life. So they never did that. So fair enough, if they now want to do it, go ahead, apply for the first time. You'll categorize yourself in category 6. Provisional registration will be granted. But there is one very important catch here, that in the reopening matters, the department has a right to reopen your previous cases and bring to tax such income that you have had in the previous 3 years. So that has to be taken care. But otherwise, you can go ahead and apply and get a provisional first-time registration. So that was one of the question. And before I conclude, I think we have almost covered all the major points. Let me just take you through the other forms which I have categorically put here. Okay. So as we've discussed, this was Form 10A, which has to be filed as of now on or before 30th of June. Okay. And some of the part will be auto-filled, auto-populated, I would say. Now let us see. 10AB as of now is not yet released. I mentioned about it. So let's not look at 10AB as of now. We'll see how this approval order of the tax department would look like. This would be something like this, the provisional approval. So the provisional approval or rejection, as the case may be, everything would be, here. It would be coming in such a form to the trust after filing their registration, the Form 10A. So this would be received twice, because you are filing 10A twice, so you'll get this twice. One will be for 12A for the charitable activity, one will be for 80G. In case if there is no 80G, then it will be only for 12A. Form 10AD is for the approval which you will get when you file Form 10AB, that is 5 years hence. So let us not look at it right now. Form 10BD, that is the statement, the additional compliance point that I was talking about. This is how it looks. And this will come with effect from financial year 21-22. So this is how the certificate has to be, the statement. Certificate is next, is the other form. So you will have to fill up the details of the donor, his address, etc., type of donation. So for example, if the same person has contributed more than, once, then you can aggregate it and put it all together. That is also doable, in aggregate in this form. And this has to be uploaded for all the donations that you got throughout this year. So it basically means that the trust will have to probably upgrade their systems, their bookkeeping systems, to keep a track, because this certainly is now a requirement from the income tax side. In case if you fail to do this, then there is a late fee, also a penalty which can be in the range of 10,000 to a lakh of rupees. And the last one is the certificate, which typically like a Form 16, but not exactly a Form 16, but yeah, it's comparable to a Form 16. This certificate is what the donor would be getting. This is which he can claim 80G deduction. And the point here is, this Form 10B would be such that In case if the trust fails to you know file the statement, then the form 10B would not be available. If the form 10B is not available, it would not be reflected in the annual information report, the AIR. And if it is not in the AIR, in that case, the particular donor would not be able to take the exemption. So this is a very, very crucial requirement going forward, which has to be taken care of. Now, the crux of the entire discussion today, to summarize it, I would say it is Form 10A filing. Appropriate attachments has to be done, and ensure that it is done within the timelines. I really don't know whether the date is going to get extended or not, but in case if the portal is allowing you to file, please do not wait for any exemptions. Please go ahead and file this application. On a safer side, it's always better, irrespectively of whether the date is going to get extended or not. So that is Form 10A, which we are seeing right now. And the certificate will come in Form 10AC. So that's about it. I think from my side, let me just look at the chat box if there are any sort of questions that has come. I think more or less things have been covered. A small disclaimer here, this was just for knowledge sharing purpose. Kindly take professional advice before proceeding with any filings on the tax portal. So let me just look at the Q&A which has come in the chat box. Okay. So I answered this, the portal will be ready hopefully soon. Difficulties. Yeah, that's correct. There is difficulties undoubtedly because it's a new portal altogether. Navigations have changed in the portal. So it may take some time, and therefore it may be expected that our dates are extended. But nevertheless, if the portal is allowing you, please go ahead and file this particular form. There is one question from Siva, which is interesting. We've received the orders in 12AB. That is great. So that means he's got 10AC form. And that means we've submitted all records correctly. Will there be any further inquiry? So as I talked, there is no inquiry which is going to be done when you apply this form. It's deemed approval because I believe your trust would have been already a registered trust in the erstwhile law. So it is always a deemed concept that has been there. But if the department finds out any attachments incorrectly put or not having the requisite details or not signed, or you have missed out in submitting, they can give you a particular notice and also an opportunity. They can't just really go ahead and cancel it. They'll give you an opportunity of being heard. But yes, there is that catch. So it is always advisable, whatever you are filing in Form 10A, it has to be properly vetted. It has to be appropriately filed so that such a ambiguity is not there that whether it can be cancelled. The department, if it finds out that you are not conducting activities genuinely, they have all the powers to come ahead and cancel your registration. In that very case, your registration would be deemed to be cancelled. You have no, I would say, exemptions. It means tax at MMR, that is the maximum marginal rate. Moving on to the next question. I have received 12A 80G provisional certificate. I need clarification. I'm not sure what that question means, but I think what you're trying to ask is, you have received 12A and 80G provisional certificate. Would there be any clarifications sought? So I think I've already answered that it won't be the case. In case if you have submitted everything correctly, it won't be the case at all. Is there any cutoff on the amount received donation for which PAN? No. Everything, all the donations have to be. There's no such cutoff. For every donation that you are going to get, a statement now will record what you are getting. You have to submit it, and a certificate will be issued to the donor so that he can take the benefit of that donation. Will you share the PPT? Sure, I'll do that. Who will issue Form 10BP? No, it is DONI or the IT department. cutoff is surely not there, but DONI or IT department. So the moment you submit your 10BD, that is the statement, 10BE would be something which would be visible on the portal and the donor has to download it. So it's not something, it's not, from the trust standpoint, it is not your compliance. It is something which would be visible on the portal once the donor logs in his personal ITR, login page. It will be visible over there. He can download it. So it's not something which, to my mind, that was the question. Is it necessary to submit audit report of financial year 2021? Mr. Arun Jindal is asking. So Arunji, here the point which you should note is, if you are an existing compliant trust, you have to submit previous 3 years, audit reports and everything, not financial year 2021. I think he's asking about financial year 2021, but that's not required. But if you are a new trust, first time registration provisionally would be given to you. And then when you file a form, for your final registration, that is in form 10AB, that may be asked in the form of a provisional, provisional set of information may be asked only when you are a new trust, not for the ones which are already into existence. I think this is an interesting question. We applied for ATG and got rejected, and the matter is now in ITAT. So can we apply ATG again as the matter is in tribunal? So here, very interesting question. There is one particular point in the form that was your ATG ever cancelled earlier. So in such a situation, you'll have to say, in case if you are applying, if you are applying again, you have to mention that it was rejected and the matter is pending in the ITAT. So that has to be taken care. It's a very interesting question that has been asked. After fresh registration, how many days we can apply for ATG? Mr. Pradeep is asking this question. Pradeep, here please note that if you are a fresh NGO, say for example, in your case, let us assume you are a fresh NGO, Section 8 company, got registered on 19th of June 2021. Your question is saying, when can we apply for ATG? So here, if you are a fresh trust, firstly, please note, you will be getting a provisional approval. A provisional registration, you can apply tomorrow. Nobody is stopping you. You can go ahead and apply. You get a provisional. But the moment you commence your activity, within 6 months from commencement, you will have to apply for final. So that is a very important question. If you don't do it, the provisional registration will be valid for 3 years. 6 months before the end of the period of 3 years, you have to again apply for final registration. That is an important point. Is there a deadline for old application at the income tax? I'm not sure what this question means. Adeline, I think you have put this question. Is there a deadline for old application in the income tax? So I believe this question is, to my mind, you're saying that it was already filed before 31st of March. It was never picked up. So then you will fall under the category 6, which I, in case if you just want to see, I'll share my slide again. It would be here in the timelines section. You'll be in the residual category. You will be in the residual category. It will be automatically considered in the residual category altogether. And you will be granted a provisional registration. And then you have to apply for a final registration also. So that is an important point here. Why is there always a change? It's a funny question. Why is there always a change in the process? That's how it is. We can't answer this question. But it is a legal requirement now to comply, and we'll have to do that. My personal PAN number is not recognized by the income tax. What to do? I think this is not really related to the topic that we are discussing, but if I were to just answer this question, I believe if your PAN number is not recognized by the income tax department, there may be, it may be because of certain errors and you need to correct it on the NSDL portal. So my suggestion is just get in touch with NSDL Pune to just check what your issue is in the PAN number. There is a question. What is the, so I see a question here. What is the information relevant for Telangana, Andhra Pradesh? Please try to understand here that this particular requirement is for all the trust everywhere in India. It's not specific to a particular state. So this has to be noted. It is coming from the Income Tax Department, which is a central authority. All the trusts in India have to comply with this thing, not specifically pertaining to some state or otherwise. Last 3 years means 1920 or 2021. It would be 1920 and prior to it, because 2021 any which ways, aapka finalized nahi hua hoga abhi. So take it before, you know, take it on or before 2019, 2020. Expired. Valid for 12A, but not filed in last zone activity. We start filing ITR. I applied, I got my 12A, but portal shows it's verified. Now, again, Javed has asked the question. He has a society and 80G. I'm not sure. Javed, here your question, you're saying you had a 80G and expired. In the erstwhile law, 80G used to be for perpetual. There was no such concept of expiry unless it is revoked by the department. So I'm not sure whether you are saying it was expired or I would consider it to be revoked. So fine, if it is revoked in the past, it's no problem. Go ahead and apply it again. Just mention that you had a 80G or 12A earlier and you are now again applying. You have to give that detail. So you're saying that 100% donation should have PAN details. Deepika, from a compliance standpoint, that is correct. Your question is 100% donations received should have PAN details. It is always advisable to take PAN details and put it in the statement from a trust standpoint, I'm saying. We issue donation receipt to our donors as a compliance. Going forward, the donation certificate would be issued by whom to our donors? Sonia is asking this question. That we issue donation receipts to donors as a compliance. That is great. You can continue with that practice. Not a problem at all. The donation certificate is firstly the statement now, which is an additional compliance on the trust. You have to file the statement. The donation certificate he will be able to get in his because you are filling the PAN details over there. You are, the moment you put down, for example, I am the donor to your trust. I am giving you my PAN number and you have given me a receipt, which is fine. But the moment next year, 31st of May, you will upload the statement, it will automatically be visible in my, income tax. It's all digitally connected now. Let me put it this way. So I hope that answers your question. Will a donor be able to see the donation by other donors in the portal? Why do you want to know that? This question is, will a donor be able to see the donations by other donor in the portal? That's not the case. It won't be the case at all. Hum donation le sakte hain. Provisional certificate se aap apna kaam shuru kar sakte hain. But as I said, provisional registration se aap kaam shuru kariye. Donation wagar aap le rahe hain, not a problem. Final registration lena mat bhuliyega. Final registration aapko within 6 months of commencement. Jaise for example, आज आपने प्रोविजनल रजिस्ट्रेशन के लिए एप्लीकेशन कर दी और आप एक्टिविटीज भी चालू कर रहे हैं, ठीक है ना? आप टुमारो इटसेल्फ यू अप्लाई फॉर फाइनल रजिस्ट्रेशन, नॉट अ प्रॉब्लम, बट यू हैव टू टेक द फाइनल रजिस्ट्रेशन. वी आर ट्राइंग टू रजिस्टर फॉर 80G 12A, बट समहाउ वी फेल टू गेट ओटीपी ऑन द रजिस्टर्ड नंबर. My suggestion here is try to upload it with the digital signature. You can use the digital signature to upload your form. It will be very well filled. But yeah, this is a This is another technical issue which Sonali is mentioning, that OTPs are not coming. So if it is not coming, try to do it the other way. Obtain a digital signature, register it on the portal, and just file your form. Thank you. Please confirm the donor asked for 80G exemption after we have uploaded 10BD. I didn't get your question, Deepika, but I think you are asking that if the donor asks for 80G certificate, I think that's your question. It will be available to him in his portal. You can just ask him to download it. We have to apply for renewal or valid. Seems last date, but 10A is not available. What are the consequences? Okay, interesting question by GGS Foundation. We have to apply for renewal, throughout their lifetime, they're saying. It seems the last day is 30th of June for filing, but 10A is not available on the new portal. In such a case, please understand that the department will come out and give some clarification, either by way of extension or maybe some sort of a relief, but it will definitely not debar you from your exemptions. That's my point. What if the donor did not give his PAN, hence we didn't upload? He comes back and asks for PAN updation. Okay, so here it is advisable to take PAN details. And in case if the donor did not give you the PAN details at a time of making the donation, and later he's coming to you, if I understand the question correctly, that's the case. If they later come to you and ask for their PAN updation, please understand this particular statement has to be done annually. So from a compliance standpoint, what you can always do is try to gather all the information throughout the year. In case if a particular person or donor has not given the donation, try and explain them that, okay, you have not given your PAN. But in case if he really wishes to take 80G, he has to give. So try to get it before 31st of May, that is next year. In case if not, although as of now, there is no clarity whether there will be some revision possible in this form. But to my mind, yes, at times it is possible to revise the statements. In case if the portal permits you to do it, please go ahead and do that so that the donor can get the exemption. I think we have already crossed the time, so let's take a pause here, and that's all from my side. We are already 10 minutes ahead of the timing, Adlina. So I think majorly everything is covered. In case if there is any other question, maybe you can just reach out to Adlina, and I'll be happy to answer them offline. But thank you for the patient listening, and thank you for your time. It was a lovely session. And I hope we can conclude. Adlina, any other point would you like to add? I'll take a pause here. Thank you. Thank you all.
Sounds good. And as I mentioned earlier in our introduction, the further questions we can accept via email. You could share your questions in the feedback form, which I've sent the link in the chat box. We can now conclude by thanking Aditya for sharing with us these insights with us. Thank you everyone for joining us for the session and for being a wonderful audience. I request you to please fill the feedback form, as it will help us to curate many more sessions like these. I've shared the link in the chat box. And as mentioned earlier, if you have any questions that remained unanswered in the session, please put a query in the feedback form, and we can request Aditya to answer the questions via email. We are organizing a webinar on succeeding with volunteers on the 14th of July. I shall be sharing the details for the same in the chat box, and you could sign up for it. We hope to see you all for this webinar, and the event is scheduled for 14th of July, which is a Wednesday. And thank you so much, participants, and we look forward to seeing you soon. Take care.